Allow me to introduce myself. I'm Grandtuhon Leo T. Gaje Jr., the Supreme Grand Masters of the Pekiti-Tirsia Kali System of the Philippines.
Now, you're here today in Ottawa training these people. How did the seminar go today? What kind of stuff did you go through?
Well, the seminar is very cultural. The cultural orientation is to bring the message of philosophy, cultural values, customs and traditions, and ideology of the Filipinos. And the participation of this gentleman, I have Tuhon, yeah, supposed to be titled in that the category because they have been with me for some time. Tuhon Philip Galina, special mention, is here in Montreal, and also Tuhon Mitch Jerome, and we have Tuhon Tyler Morin of Toronto. They are very supportive in propagating the Filipino culture here in Canada, and they had been very active in participation in our activities worldwide.
Now that's great. So this is a who's who in this very room in Ottawa today of the Filipino martial arts.
Well, that's what they say. But humbly speaking, is that, you know, I had been in the Hall of Fame 3 times. I was the first one to be a recipient of the Hall of Fame of the kickboxing and karate, which I was not in karate. And I was also in the United States Martial Arts Hall of Fame and also the International Hall of Fame. But I was the only Filipino that was in the Police Hall of Fame, recipient of the Edgar Holland, Edgar Hoover Memory Tourist Award.
That's quite an impressive resume. Talk to us a bit about how it all started. Like, where did you start your training back in the day?
Well, the discipline here is called Kali. Kali is a Filipino philosophy, but it was brought to the Philippines by the influence of the Srivijaya Empire that ruled the Malay race for 800 years. Our writing is Sanskrit writing, which is Indian in origin. Our language is also spoken in some Indian language, like Guru, and also our metaphysical healthy treatment for curing the sick and you know, the aged. See, this culture has been established our forefathers as one of our foundations of the character and also the discipline and also the cooperation of the community in terms of farming and economics. The Filipinos were very jealous, passive people in the early times. But with the arrival of Ferdinand Magellan in 1521, Ferdinand Magellan was the conquistador and the famous circumnavigator of the world. He is representing the King of England and also Queen Isabella. He had already conquered the whole Latin America, and after his completion, he tried to venture to the other side of the world, and accidentally he landed in the island of Cebu, which is the Philippines. The Philippines has 3 big islands, and one of these islands is close to my island, which is Negros, and Magellan landed in the island of Cebu. He was received by the Dato, or the chieftain of the island, with gracious hospitality. And he was given a black pearl, the biggest pearl in the Orient. And Ferdinand Magellan was very much impressed, and he was offering Datu Humabon, which was the chieftain of the village. He said, "I will make you the gobernadorcillo of Cebu under the blessing of the King of Spain, King Philip." But Datu Humabon says, "That is easy, but you see, I have a problem the other side of the island, in the island of La Mactan. I have a friend there, but he is fighting with me because we are fighting against this sea, you know, fishing sea. In other words, the supply of fish from both islands is taken from this channel. But he said, if you can take care of this guy, you know, I will accept that. You know, I will see to it that, you know, you are probably recognized." So Ferdinand Magellan, with the pride, says, "No, I will go there. I have no problem with that. You know, I have 40 of my men that will cross the channel." So he says, "Okay, guys, you prepare yourselves." So they are fully armored. They were fully armored, and then they try to land in the other side of the island. And it so happened that the island is having this low tide. So the vessel of Magellan was not able to anchor near to the beach for them to dismount. So they got stuck on the mud. And then the people of Dato Lapu-Lapu, which is the chieftain of the Mactan, start throwing stones and bow and arrow, and there was a close fight in the island. And out of this, you know, Ferdinand Magellan, but Magellan was a famous blade fighter also. Then they don't know that the natives there are very smart also. So since they were armorized, Then the Dato of Lapu-Lapu thought a way that to immobilize Banjilan. He used a pointed stick, a long stick, and thrust into the knee, which is open. And then the Magellan fell down, and then Lapu-Lapu tried to rush him and take his head off and cut his neck and then raise it up. So out of 40 people, only 14 survived, of the people of Magellan. So the chronicler of Magellan, whose name is Pigafetta, was recording all of this. As a matter of fact, there are some records there in Spain, yeah, especially in the place where the museum is in Murcia, that the history, as far as the fight between Magellan and Lapu-Lapu, was immensely very interesting because it was a test of skill. But Magellan, of course, you know, died, and Pigafetta went back to Cebu, reported to Dato Humabon. He says, your Majesty, you know, your chief, he said, you know, we're sorry to tell you that Pedro Magellan was killed by Lapu-Lapu. So the impression of Abon is, well, that is a Filipino. Yeah, I cannot say anything, but he says, the Pigafetta requested that if he could bring the body of Magellan to Spain. And Pigafetta says, send some messenger. So he sent a messenger to the island of Mactan Island. And Dato Lapu-Lapu said, you want the head? I have the body. But I will not give you the body because I have the head. So he didn't get anything from Dato of Mactan Island, Lapu-Lapu. So the chieftain of the messenger went back to the Dato Humabon and reported, says, no, Lapu-Lapu will not give anything. So the expedition went back to Spain with some of the Filipino voyagers, and they picked up some people from Mexico, from Acapulco, went back to Spain and reported to King Philip of Spain. He says, your Highness, we are sorry to tell you that, you know, Ferdinand Magellan was killed in the Battle of Mactan. And then he said, why, describe me, what is that island? He says, the island is full of barbarians. What else? He says, it is here, your Majesty, we have the pearl, the biggest pearl. It has plenty of pearls. And then what else? He says, that island is the island of St. Lazarus. He said, don't mention that name. Make that island in my name. So that island says, Philip, and what is the landmark? And then the chronicler says, the landmark are all pine trees. Because in Spain, there are no other trees except pine trees. So these people recognize only the pine trees. In the Philippines, there are so many trees. So he said, name that island, Philip Pines. So the Philippine was named Philippines. There's a dust. Right? So from then on, the name of the Philippines was Philippines. And the king says, we are not going anymore to send military people. We have already sent our expedition for expedition, and they were all demolished in the Pacific because of the high tide and high waves, and the sea is very cruel. We are going to send holy men. So they sent Miguel Lopez de Legazpi with his crew, and accidentally he landed in one of the islands in Cebu, which in summer late, which he put up a cross, signifying that they landed safely in the island. So from this on, the Filipinos were receiving doctrine of Catholicism. Hmm. And it spread a lot because, you know, there was no violence on the part of the priest and the sacristans. So the Philippines was educated in terms of Catholic religion. And the most important thing is that the Spaniards for 333 years established the only university in the Far East, which is Santo Tomas University. They bring the Filipino to some Spanish speaking, but the only thing is that they change the names of Filipinos. They change my name, they change other names, and everybody is...
They've been known to do that.
Yeah, well, they change the name into the Spanish name. And then the interesting part is that they took the island and titled a Torrens title in the name of Queen Isabella. So the Philippines was not actually Philippines by that time, but it was already a extension of Spain. But the abuses of the priests and the abuses of the soldiers made the Filipino bad, because they took some of the beautiful wives, they took some of the women, and then they abused it, including the priests. So the Filipinos revolted against Spain. And there were 8 provinces that revolted against Spain. And there were lots of killing. And the one that was used by the Filipino fighters is the use of the Filipino blade, called the ginunting in the Talibong. These two blades are very furious and very, they were made especially for cutting neck, you know. Right. When you are hit by that, you know, half of your body is get cut off. So the Filipinos are very expert in this because that is their culture. Then, for 303 years, we were fighting with the Spaniards. And there were many Spaniards. So Spaniards getting fewer and fewer in the Philippines. And then the King of Spain says, we will find a way that we will not be put into shame. How can we get out from the Philippines? So somebody suggested, you know, we negotiate with the Americans that we are going to sell these Filipinos to the Americans. So they negotiated the deal with America in the Treaty of Paris of 1898. And there, the Americans bought the Filipinos at $3 per head. It is the people that were sold by Spain to America, not the island. So they made they paid the Philippines around $20 million for the number of people that were there. So Filipinos had a good relation with America because Americans made the Filipino men to be soldiers in the armed forces of the United States. So there were 20,000 between 20,000 Filipinos and American in the Philippines. And they were there from 1907-1920. And what was interesting is that the Americans brought another way of influencing the Filipinos by bringing the American education. English speaking and all of this and all of this, but didn't deal too much on about religion, only education. And this education was a part of the development of the Filipinos. So we speak Filipino, we speak Spanish, and we speak Americans. And what was the thing that they made it very significant is the intermarry with the Filipino women, and there are Filipino women and Filipino men, and also this, when the children comes out, you know, it's, well, he looks like he's Spanish, he looks like Americans, you know what I mean? The color of Filipinos is gone already, see? So the interfacing between the Americans and the Filipinos were constant, but here comes 1941, the Japanese invaded the country. And 200,000 with all the forces of Japan invading the Philippines. The Americans lost in the Philippines. General Win Wright surrendered, and there was a presence of the Japanese for 2 years. But the Filipinos didn't stop fighting the Japanese. They hide in the mountains and then they kill them one by one by guerrilla tactics. So the Japanese also were losing their population. And General MacArthur from the Philippines, he went back to the United States and talked to the Congress and Senate. And he told the Congress and Senate that I promised the Filipinos I shall return. The reason I want to go back to the Philippines because give me 10,000 Filipinos, I will conquer the world. Wow. And the Congress and the Philippines was impressed because what is in the Filipino way of life that, you know, you are going to go back there? You lost already in the Philippines. But he persuaded, so the full forces of the Americans went back to the Philippines. And when the Japanese was going out from the Philippine Sea, they were met by General MacArthur in the Battle of the Philippine Sea, the famous battle in the Pacific. That ends the occupation of the Japanese. But the story was, the Filipinos were still using the cultural discipline of blade fighting. And during the Spanish time, the Filipino family, they grouped themselves together, and then they studied the way how the Spaniards fight with the blade. And they studied this in terms of counter defensive program, okay? The counter offensive training. You know, like, you hit me with a blade, I go back, and then, you know, in other words, we don't block the blade, right? Mm-hmm. You trust me, I trust you, you die, see? So they have developed a very extensive training in research how to fight against the Spaniards. How to fight also the Americans, because when the Americans came there, they used the 38 revolver and Kruger rifles, but they were losing because the Filipinos attacked them secretly, hiding in the trees, hiding in the grasses, and then they attacked suddenly and killed the Americans. So the Americans were losing also in number. So the War Department had initiated to develop a powerful gun, which is a 45 caliber, against the Filipinos. So the 45 caliber model 1911 was developed against the Filipinos in the Philippines. So that when the Filipino is charging you with the blade, you shoot him in this distance, you know, mm-hmm. you can stop it. But if it's a 38 revolver, no, you cannot. So there was no 100% stopping on the Filipinos. We're still fighting by using the guerrilla tactics, using the bow and arrow, using the blowgun, using all of these things. So the Americans trying to appease with the Filipinos by giving us Commonwealth. just like we did in Puerto Rico, Commonwealth. And then we accepted the Commonwealth. So we are well at peace in the Philippines with the Americans. But the most interesting part of this history is that of all the three nations, Spain, America, and Japan, were all defeated in the Philippines.
Right.
They were all defeated. So when it comes to martial arts language, or especially the history of martial arts, we are the only martial arts in the world that had fought with three countries. There was no history about the karate fighting another country or another country. There was no history about judo fighting another country and kill them, you know. There was a history of taekwondo, you know, flying there and killing the enemy. In our history, we have proven that we have removed the Spaniards, we have removed the Americans, and we have also the Japanese. So present today, the Filipino fighting system, in my system, is the Pekiti-Tirsia Kali. The Pekiti-Tirsia Kali was founded in 1897 by my grandfather and the great-grandfathers before that. So my system is pure. It has been filtered with the technique that technique will kill immediately. In one touch you die.
Mm-hmm.
In one touch we capture you, in one touch. It was perfected under the principles of combat geometry. So if you don't know geometry, the geometry is perfect, you know, with the different angulation, different movements, and different estimate of the calculation of the, if you are a construction engineer, you know that. But in war, there is a perfection. So they study this and review and review and review. And this is now being a part, or no, this is now a major training program of the Armed Forces of the Philippines, which I handle the program of the Philippine Army and the Philippine Navy, and the Philippine Air Force and the Philippine government, and so they, including the Special Security Command, as the Scout Ranger. India also is adopting our system with more than 1,300,000 all involved in our system. We have also the Austrian Cobra Commandos. We have also the Spain Squadron, 300,000, right? So the Pekiti-Tirsia is now heavily involved in terms of military and law enforcement. And we are still growing. As a matter of fact, there are great demand of this system in other countries. Because even here in the United States, we open up the program of entry point here with the criminal justice system, and the criminal justice system was able to produce a surviving edge weapon video, which is the national training video in the United States now among the law enforcement. So our program is to provide the installation of proper discipline in terms of survival, mm-hmm. in terms of protection, and in terms also of in inviting the people to be more participant in terms of philosophy. Because the philosophy of this art is to believe in life, not to believe in death. To believe in success, not to believe in failure. To believe in good health, not to believe in sickness. So your belief is the one that will fortify your protection against any kind of diseases. Good health, success. Because if you're fighting about the successful, life, your life is that you have to protect your life. And this is the one that is very strong now in terms of how we bring discipline to the people. So there is a great demand for our technology, but we are run out of people. And our purpose here is to build up more people to be proficient and be able to deliver the message of the right culture, not the karate, the judo, the aikido. It has to be exactly perfect in terms of how it is. So there are lots of appreciation, but the way we train, it is hard training, right? We always give them the test of pain, which our people are afraid of pain.
I witnessed that today.
Because pain is the sweetness of your labor, of your working out. So this is the most important thing. So here in Canada, we have I have around five Tuhons here. We have Tuhons here at the higher level. We have in Montreal, we have in Toronto, we have in here in Ottawa, we have also in Vancouver, we have in Saskatchewan, and also in Toronto, and also in that place. So the big Pekiti-Tirsia system is very solid here in Canada. We are coming now to what we call the sports. We are going to go into the Olympic, we're stick fighting Olympians. So, you know, we have countries now, we have around 15 to 20 countries that are now involved in this training. So here in Canada, we have a very good group of people that are really dedicated, because Tuhon Philip here has been with me for 45 years. Mm-hmm. He has lots of experiences, and his name and capabilities in terms of full contact fighting is represented by the Doe brothers.
That's right.
And this particular practices is inviting the people to be more stronger and to be more serious in terms of training, in the reality of how to fight and survive. That is the most important. We believe in life, we don't believe in death. We believe in success. We believe, don't believe in failure. We are training for combat. If you are a combat-oriented trained person and you fight in sport, you will win sports. But if you know only sport, you cannot win in combat.
Right.
Yeah. So we don't release our training by just dedicating for sports. Sport is only a part of combatancy.
Sure.
But we are using the sticks. Sticks are what you call it, impact weapon, and it has proven time and again that, you know, the stick training will provide an experience for people to be more proficient and to be more agile and be more careful, and you'll be more so dedicated to train, so that when the sparring or combat sparring is concerned, yeah, you can survive. But there is some little pain, that's all right. Sometimes little blood dropping in, you know, that's all right, you know, but that's sure. That's a part of the game,
yep.
Rather than you be killed. So, anyway, the whole spectrum of the system is to see to it that we provide a class of people that would be ready at any time to protect their family, to protect their country, and to protect every members of the family and also friends. Because there is now the presence of the expansion of terrorism. We have the ISIS and all other forms of terrorism. And there's some of the, what do you call that, renegades, and some of the, what do you call that, extremists. We cannot wait until the time that, you know, if there is a massacre, you know, we are not doing anything. We should be careful and should continue to be on guard, because the enemy that we don't know and we don't see is the one that will destroy us. So our preparation in terms of training must be really complete, in such a way that when we produce good people, they are really good people, because they are prepared physically, mentally, spiritually. So we are changing the course of martial arts. We are not commercializing the issue. We see to it that everybody contributes their share in terms of how they can be trained and how they will spend their time and how the things can be fruitful for wherever they go. They can go anywhere and they are prepared. Because the purpose of training is to keep you aware, keep you alert, and you have the skill to execute in terms of protecting yourself. We are teaching the right procedure. As far as aggressiveness is concerned, comes out when the reality of combat is concerned, is detected, or it is necessary that we use aggressiveness, we have to be aggressive. But in normal life, we know we are passive, because we have that influence of the Srivijaya Empire for a long time. And that passiveness meaning is not to be underestimated by enemy, because I'm trying to be good to you, you know. I don't show any hatred or things like that. Of course, you know, it's easy to take any action. So, lesson coming from Pekiti-Tirsia is important, because we have a name for the last 40 years. We have been in Discovery Channel, we were in History Channel, we are in BBC and all of these magazines that are coming out. So we have a name and we have a credibility. So we always say to it that our effort and our skill must be a part of the community, and that the community must have to take an effort to really learn the process. Mm-hmm. Because without learning, you know, you'll be a lame duck. You'll be a victim and you'll die. We don't want anybody. That's why we have programmed in the Philippines, zero casualty. In the military, zero casualty.
Wow.
Zero casualty. Law enforcement must be zero casualty. Meaning zero casualty, you have to be triply alert as a police, as a military, as a civilian. And what brings that kind of attention? It is because you are trained in the perfection of science, the science of geometry.
Thank you very much for your time, Grandtuhon. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for everybody that are listening to this program. Thank you.